Welcome to another episode of Yuan Explains. Today we're going to take a look at one of the classics, the rhythmically complex keyboard solo on Genesis Firth of Fifth. Let's do it. Firth of the Fifth is a classic that appeared on Selling England by the Pound, released back in 1973. And there's like a bunch of covers of Tony Banks' piano intro, but not that many covers of the intro on steroids, I mean the instrumental odd time section. And this is a tricky one. There's just not one steady odd time signatures like in the solo, for example, on Robbery, Assault, and Battery. The time signatures, they change all the time. But they do that in a most natural way. You hardly think about it. The music just flows in that typical Genesis way. They were really masters of making complex music just sound natural and musical and beautiful. And I've said this before, but this might be especially true for this piece of music. I was able to sing along and air drum along to this section as a kid. And later, as a young musician, I got more precise doing it, but I never analyzed it. And I had no clue when it came to time signatures. I just felt it. It was the Genesis effect. But today, I'll break it down for you and show you exactly what time signatures this piece has. And about that, there is a misconception about time signatures. They're not just about mathematics. Let's just take 13/8 as an example. Some people count that as an 8/8 bar followed by a 5/8 bar because 5 plus 8 is 13. And that makes sense mathematically. But you might as well count it as a 7/8 bar followed by a 6/8 bar. That's also 13. Or the other way around. But which one is correct? So what I do in my videos, I try to lock the time signature to the intent of the composition. That is, I try to fit the time signatures to the melody and the rhythm pattern that I hear. I want to find the theoretical description of the music that makes the most sense when trying to sing and play along. To me, there's a difference between a 7/8 bar followed by a 6/8 bar or the other way around. It's all about the music that I hear. And this is especially important in this piece because there are so many time signature changes. And I have broken it down for you in the best way I possibly can. I want you to be able to understand it, feel it, and ultimately play it. So we do what we do in these episodes. We start with my playthrough and break it down after. And the version I've worked with for this video is the live version from When in Rome from 2007. I liked it because it's different from the older versions. It's full of energy and it goes insanely fast. It's not super tight, but rather full of energy and groove. And I linked to it in the description. We'll be right back. So I hope you enjoyed my little playthrough. I had a lot of fun doing that. So let's talk about this. What is going on? Because there is a lot of time signatures in here. So I'm going to take you into Reaper and discuss this a little bit. And then I'm going to play through it at half speed and show you all the time signatures so you can learn it and play it. So here we are in Reaper. And the first thing I want to show you is that here is my timeline from left to right. And this is the entire piece that I'm playing, the entire keyboard solo. Start here and it stops here. And you see all these numbers up here. I don't expect you to be able to read them, but you see there's a bunch of numbers here. So if I zoom in, you see that there are numbers appearing over and over again here. And every time you see a number up here, it means that the time signature is changing. So it starts with this time signature and it changes and it changes and it changes and it changes. So the time signature changes all the time in this piece, which I feel is very interesting and the first thing I want to show you. I'm going to take you through some key parts of this solo before we do the entire thing in slow motion and I give you all the time signatures, just so you get a feel for how this is built up. And I'm going to talk you through the yellow part here, which is the first part, which is like this. Which is then repeated. The green part is just the repeat of the yellow part. So what are the time signatures here? It starts by 4-4, which I see as 8-8 because everything here is eights to me. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, like that. The first part, that is just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's just 4-4. And then we have the bouncing 6-8 part, which is classic 6-8. So is 8-8, and then you have which makes it two of those 6-8s. And then there are a 4-8 bar, which is like a half bar to make it work. And then when we start over with the next part, which is this, you have kind of the same thing. You have 8-8s, which is just 4-4, 8-8s. And then you have the same bouncing 6-8, but there's just one, followed by a classic 7-8. That's just 7-8. So that is the first part. 4-4, and then 6-8, 6-8, 4-8, and then we start over with 4-4, 6-8, and 7-8. So that's the entire yellow part. Let's listen to that again. And then repeat. Then there are two what I call stationary parts in the solo. The first stationary part, what I call stationary part, is this one. Which is repeated. This one is in 13-8. And it's different to me because normally when you play 13-8, I don't know how normal that is, but usually what I hear when I hear bands playing 13-8 is that it's a 7-8 followed by a 6-8. Like in Robbery, Assault, and Battery. Here is the other way around, that they start with a 6-8 and then the 7-8. Which is, of course, open for debate, but this is the way I see it. It's 6-8 followed by 7-8, like this. So So that is what I call the first stationary part. And then there is another very effective stationary part where the guitar comes in. So let's listen to that. And that part is also very interesting rhythmically. It starts by a 4-4, or what I call 8-8, and is followed by a 6-8, and then 7-8. So it's like the previous stationary part, which is a 6-8 and 7-8, but here we also have an 8-8 first, and then the 6-8, and then the 7-8, like this. So those are the two that I call the stationary parts. Tying together those two stationary parts is a section that can be mistaken for 4-4, because this is an unusual one. It's 15 eighths. And if you count it sloppy, it almost feels like a 4-4, but it's not. It's 15-8. As I see it, it's an 8-8 followed by a 7-8. And it goes like this. And then we're into that second stationary part. So as I see it, these are the key sections to understand when you analyze this piece of music. So now I'm going to play it through in slow motion, and I'm going to show you all the time signatures. Here we go. So there you have it, the odd time section, the keyboard solo of Firth of the Fifth by Genesis. I hope you liked the video, I hope you got something out of it, and I hope you like my content. If you do, please hit that like and subscribe button, it really means a lot to me. Thank you for watching.